Hello, John. Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for joining us.
You all right?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, good, thank you. It's just a bit warm.
Yeah, definitely better than yesterday, but...
It's a little bit less windy.
Yeah.
It was a bit crazy the other day.
Yeah. So, thank you for joining us. For anyone who doesn't know, Holly is a 4-times world and Commonwealth European and Paralympic javelin thrower. So, could you tell us a little bit about how you got into athletics?
Of course. So, I've always been quite a sporty girl. I've liked everything from cricket, rugby, basketball, just everything. And when I was about 11, 12 years old, me and my brother, Ash, we went to an event. It's in Cleethorpes, which I was originally from, and it's called Star Trek. And you could go and try any event you wanted, you know, no pressure, no nothing. So I just remember my brother picking up the javelin and throwing it. And I was like, right, I really want to copy him. You know, I want to go and beat him, as typical sort of competitive sister. And I threw it and everyone was just like, wow, like, have you ever thrown a javelin before? Like, you know, have you done this sport before? And I was just like, no, not at all. So, yeah, it kind of happened from there. I joined that club, and a couple of years later, really, my first ever major competition was Beijing 2008 Paralympics. So I was literally chucked into the deep end straight away.
So for Beijing, yeah, that was your first Paralympics.
Yeah.
And you were only 14 at the time. So what was that like?
To be honest, really, as a 14-year-old, maybe most people will think it was like really scary, but I loved it. You know, it was a big opportunity for me to take, and you know, I was going there as for fun, you know, and to have all the experience about, you know, being at a Paralympics and experiencing the village and, you know, seeing all of these different countries. And so I had no pressure, which was great, because obviously then every other Paralympics I've had has always been pressure. So I think to me, it was, you just have to enjoy all the experiences you've been given, and being 14 and having my first ever Paralympics in Beijing and have my mum and dad in the crowd. It was, yeah, it was amazing. Considering it was 90,000 people there, it was, yeah, it was a little bit scary, but I loved it.
Well, we're glad you enjoyed it. So Rio was your gold medal.
Yeah.
How was that whole opportunity?
Obviously with London, obviously I didn't medal at that time. I knew that there was another 4 years to be able to gain strength, gain power, and, you know, get better at javelin. So I always thought to myself that I wanted to win Rio. Rio was mine. So I trained hard. I moved to different countries. I did everything I could. And just getting out there in Rio, obviously I was so nervous. Probably didn't eat, drink or sleep for like a week. But yeah, you kind of just got to take experiences as it comes, you know. And I've already been to 2 Paralympics beforehand. So I thought, right, this is my opportunity to take everything with, I guess, both one hand. And yeah, just being out there, and it was 11 o'clock. It was 11:01, actually, in the morning. It was boiling hot. It was about 40 degrees. So I was literally sweating like I am now. Honestly, and like, you know, I could see my mum and dad in the crowd, and my brother and my boyfriend, the massive GB flag. I was like, oh my god, here we go. But yeah, you know, I was on it that day. I was really focused. I was just like, right, let's do this. And yeah, and obviously I don't think I've ever mentioned this before, but I was actually injured going into Rio. So I had I don't really know what it was, but I had a sort of a small injury within the shoulder. It was like an impingement. So I hadn't actually thrown the javelin probably for about 4 months. So it was like, look, it was like, well, you're going to have to pick the javelin up, and it's either going to go well or it's not. So when I first picked the javelin up to have a warm up throw, and it went quite far, I was like, okay, like, Holly's back. Like, this is for mine for taking. And I think the first throw, I broke the world record. It was an unbelievable feeling. You know, I've been chasing that for 10 years, and to get that, and then to become Paralympic champion and the world record holder in 2016, it was just, yeah, dreams kind of came true. It sounds really cheesy, but yeah, it was fantastic.
Yeah, no. So, as you did mention, you have only got one arm.
Yeah.
What's that been like with training and your experience of athletics in general?
Okay, so I guess I was just born like it, really. So we had no explanation of why I had a missing right forearm, but my parents kind of grew me up to be just somebody who gets on with it. You know, the Arnold way is get it done. And you know, I'm so lucky that I've had the support of my parents. They've never sort of held me back with anything. They've always let me try and do things my way, or always find an adaptive way, really. And I think I struggled mostly when I was probably about the age of sort of 13s to 17s. You know, I was growing up, I was changing, obviously lots of hormones. I always felt like I was the odd one out. It always looked different to my friends. Again, boys were on the scene then, and I didn't really, you know, felt like the odd one out. So, but yeah, everyone gets bullied. Everyone sort of has different issues, and I kind of had that in school, but it's life. It's just life. And I've never sort of looked at myself and gone, well, I can't change myself. I can't grow my arm back. So I am who I am. And you know, you've got to learn to accept yourself. And at the end of the day, I don't see my disability as a disability. It's something that has actually put me in an amazing places and opportunities, because I wouldn't be sitting here today being proud of the champion and everything I am. So you just gotta deal with what you've got and make the best life, because we only get one, right? So yeah.
So, obviously your sport is javelin, but I know you've tried a few others. Which ones are your do you enjoy otherwise besides?
I do not like running. I used to do 100 meters, 200 meters, 150 meters back then when I was younger. I actually like relay. I love relay, but it's, yeah, I'm not as fast as some of the arm amps in my classes in the running. But I love discus. So obviously discus is not an event in the Paralympics for the F46, which I am. It's only javelin, so I'm kind of gutted that I'm not able to do like two events, because I think sometimes when you do two events, you kind of relax a little bit, because you know, if you have, you probably have like your main events, but you end up doing so well in both usually. And I haven't chucked a discus for years, years and years and years, but it's very kind of similar to javelin, really. You still have the hip action, and obviously again, you throw the javelin forward and then discus you sideways. But in correlation, yeah, it's probably one of my favorites.
So you've moved around a bit with training and things like that. So up at Loughborough now.
Yeah.
Why back here from Bromley?
So obviously I lived in Wales, so Cleethorpes was my athletics track there. I actually obviously then moved to Wales, and I was competing for GB, so that's obviously my main one. But my coach Dave Turner, he's involved with that, and my training partner Becca, she's also with you guys. And you know, we wanted something that could push me and be able to compete with female able-bodied javelin throwers, and that's kind of what I wanted to do. So and obviously Dave always raves about you guys, and you know, Becca's competed for you as well. So, and yeah, I just kind of wanted to feel a part of a team. So I know you're not exactly close to me, but you know, hopefully when this is all over and next year, fingers crossed, I'll be able to go out there and compete for you.
Yeah, no, it sounds good for next season. So obviously with all your experiences internationally, you must have travelled to quite a few places. Which ones have been your favourite just to be to, which to go to, and as well, which ones to compete at?
Okay, so probably number one has to be Australia. It was fantastic going out there. You know, I was out there for about 6 weeks. I'd been to Australia before, but it wasn't really, it was a bit of a holiday, but I didn't really get to see that much. It was in Adelaide, so but yeah, being the Gold Coast was just for training facilities. You know, you're out in the sun, you get to enjoy the weather, and obviously for a power event, the heat really helped me. I just loved the competition. It was, you know, it was just packed. It wasn't as busy as I've ever, you know, sort of competed in before. But yeah, Australia was probably one of my best places to go, because I got to enjoy the competition then and then afterwards as well. So I never really get to do that. I never really have that much time off. So to enjoy things, I will say I do have time off. And I'm trying to think of my other ones, really. I guess it's got to be like, you know, Rio. Again, it was going out there for the Paralympics, so it was kind of something that it was my job first. I never really got to see anything after. I got to celebrate probably with my family, and probably did a little bit of tourist stuff for about 2 days. But again, you know, when you're kind of going out there to do a competition, it's your job, it's what you need to do. You need to focus on that rather than obviously enjoying yourself. But you can always enjoy yourself after.
So following on from Rio as well, you then got your MBE. So what was that experience like?
Oh, it was amazing. I can't believe it was 2017 when I actually got my MBE. Time honestly flies by. I was so humble and privileged to, you know, to be able to be honoured with an MBE, and the fact that it was for, you know, my credits to field events, you know, again, track always takes priority. And again, get more media and things like that. So I guess for me, it was, we're trying to, you know, step it up. We want javelin to be more of a forefront in the, you know, rather than the background. So to me, I kind of didn't feel like I deserved it. But, you know, at the end of the day, I got it. And hopefully, you know, in the next coming years, I can be respected and never know, end up like Dame Jessica Ennis Hill.
No, it'd be good. You definitely deserved it. So, how's training been for you during the lockdown?
It's been difficult. I've struggled for quite a few weeks because at the end of the day, I can't really throw javelin in the back garden and I can't go out in parks when we've not really been allowed to. And really mentally, with obviously the Paralympics not being this year now, I've struggled. I've needed time to get my head over it because obviously most of my training and my work I do day in, day out is for these massive events. And now the big events has been taken away. I don't have anything to strive for at the moment. I don't feel like I have anything that's structurally in place for me. Obviously, I know the Paralympics is next year, but it's not the same. It's not the same as when in your head for years and years, you've been going 2020, 2020, 2020, Tokyo, Tokyo. It is hard, but I think I've really enjoyed this time to just like relax and just like just make sure mentally that I'm okay, ready for next year, because we all need time. And I think everyone's dealt with it differently. People have been going crazy with training and still going training full force, where I've taken a step back where I've needed to and done things that I enjoy and don't get to do sort of within the day. So I think everyone's struggled, but you know, just gotta deal with it, and we're still kind of in this situation. So
training for Tokyo, how was that up until, unfortunately,
this happened? Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, it was going well. We had obviously in last year was Dubai, so it was really late in the season, so I think that we kind of had to change every training and different things because everything was shifted within the evening. So like later in the year, so training had to be changed very dramatically. And you know, I felt like I was in winter for so long, and then hopefully then was this year was meant to start prepping for Tokyo, and it was going well. I was really enjoying training, and obviously I haven't thrown as much as I wanted to, but sometimes it's about doing the other things and getting the marginal bits and bobs that you can maybe do at home, like mobility and things like that, which I've been trying to get better at, and then ready prep for me for throwing for when I can actually throw.
Yeah. So how was your, so you have a world record, and I know at one point you had another competition, you got there, so on for a little bit further, and then, so how was that?
Yeah, well, I currently, sadly enough, I currently don't hold the world record at the moment. I haven't really had a chance to defend it, but, so that was in 2018 Commonwealth Games. Obviously it was the first time ever that our disability event was in a Commonwealth Games. So Holly, my main rival from New Zealand, she broke the world record, or my world record at the time, on her first throw. So I was like, okay, you know, you've got to be prepared for them, because I never go out in a competition going, you know, I'm a world record holder, I'm a gold medalist. You just go out there on a clean slate, you know, anybody can take that. It's for anybody's taking. So yeah, she obviously threw the world record, and I kind of went to my coach, and he was like, okay, you know, she's done what she's done. Let's crack on. You know, you've got 5 more throws. You know, you can do this. We've worked really hard, and we had a plan and things like that. So you just got to trust in the process, and I trust my coach. I trust what we do in training for these events. So, and then obviously I was building and building. I was throwing further and further and further, and then it came to the last round, and I was like, okay, you've literally got one more throw to take this back, to take this gold medal and the world record back. And obviously it was quite amazing, really. The crowd, there was no Australians in our event, so actually they were cheering for me, which was crazy. Probably because Australia and New Zealand have a bit of a rivalry, but you know, I just, again, I remember pulling my sleeve up, no idea why, and just getting the crowd going and screaming, and it was just, the adrenaline was just going and going, and you have to be prepared for that split second for it to go wrong or right. So I just remember running up, and as soon as the javelin left my fingertips, I knew that it'd gone. I knew that I'd thrown further than I have done the competition, but I didn't know where it'd gone. So I guess that, you know, the 30 seconds wait of your score, it was just turned around and screamed, because I was like, ah, I don't even know why. You just comes, all the emotion and the adrenaline comes out. And I remember waiting for that 30 seconds and went round where the scoreboard was, and somebody was actually kind of stood in the way, but all I could see was 44. And as soon as I saw 44, I knew I'd break the world record. I knew that I possibly could take this gold medal back, because Holly had still one more throw left. So it was just an incredible emotional ride, roller coaster of that whole competition. And then obviously Holly then, because it goes in reverse order, Holly had one more throw, and you know, I was obviously willing it myself for it to not go as far, but you know, she had a chance to take it back, and she didn't throw as far and far, and that was it. I won the competition. I just remember running to my coach, Dave, and crying, but luckily the cameras were kind of behind me, so no one could see me. I don't mind, I was crying, but it was quite a special moment. So yeah, and just, you know, my family being there, and obviously my brother was living in Australia at that time, so it was just, yeah, the whole experience was incredible.
So as well, you said that you could kind of feel it, you knew once you'd thrown it that it was gonna go quite far.
Yeah.
So have you got any tips for anyone who is training in javelin or wants to start?
Okay. Javelin is a tricky sport, and I think that I don't feel like I've had proper training until I sort of moved to Loughborough. So even though I've been training for years and years and years, I only started learning the proper basics of how to throw javelin. You know, you need to be able to be good at plyometrics. You need to be sort of good on quick sprints. You need to be strong, but not too strong. I think some people think that you need to be so strong and lifting so much weight and squatting things, you know, ridiculous amounts. You don't need that. You just need a base level of power. It's all about power to weight ratio, really. So for me, was when I came to Loughborough with my new coach, Dave Turner, it was stripping back the basics and getting used to the things that I never really could do properly. And if you can't do the basics, then you're never going to be able to throw far. So yeah, and it's just about protecting your shoulder as well. Obviously I've only got one arm, so I, you know, my shoulder is everything I use every single day, and you don't realize how sore and how overtired your arm gets. And then when you go into throwing, it's not about how many throws you do, it's about the quality. You know, it's about the quality, it's not about the quantity. So just, yeah, tips is be careful and, you know, make sure that you have a good coach if possible, and that you study the event, really. So, yeah.
Well, brilliant. Thank you for talking to us today. I think if we leave it there, but thank you very much.
My pleasure.